Today, I'm answering more of your questions with the second part of the OptiPlex Q&A. And I'm sorry if you hear any banging. I've got some construction going on down here, which will mean some changes for the channel, as I'll be moving my filming into a new area. If you want to see updates on that, check out my social media or my YouTube community tab, which I'll have links to down in the description. Getting to our first question, what makes you want to build with old pre-built computers? Honestly, I didn't ever plan to make any videos on OEM systems. It really started because I built three new systems in the span of a year for no other reason than just wanting to because I really enjoy building things, especially PCs. Regardless, that's really not sustainable, and I needed to find a healthier outlet, so I bought five old Optis and found that there were a lot of different systems that looked the same. And I didn't know it at the time, but that research became the first video that I'd do that would really get any attention. I also bought 5 GPUs and SSDs with the intent to just do some simple gaming builds and flip them. But I didn't know how big of a GPU could fit and immediately found that the ones that I bought didn't. So 15 minutes later, the drive cage was gone, and then the GPU was throttling, so I added a front fan and so on. I ended up really enjoying the process, not just building and modding them, but also because most of the people that are buying them are getting their first gaming PC. And I just really enjoy seeing their excitement getting into the hobby, not to mention helping lower the amount of e-waste. So, long story longer, I wanted to satisfy that drive without losing any money on it, and it's just grown into what it is now. And that leads right into our next question. I recently acquired 5 Optis ranging from 3020s to 9020s for my office, and they all work. Should I just wipe them and resell, or try to upgrade and sell? I know, this answer comes a bit late and I'm sorry about that, but it couldn't be helped. I'm sure you've already made a decision, but hopefully this can help other people wondering the same thing. Anyways, he got them all for free, so you can't really go wrong. I mean, you'll make money either way, but it really depends on how you want to sell them, and I can only give you my own anecdotal experience because your area and the markets you have access to might be completely different from mine. And what I've found is that if you just wanted to flip them as is, I'd do it over eBay. Those don't sell very well in my area, but they sell pretty well on eBay. People are willing to overspend for these things on top of paying shipping. Now, I'm not saying you should exploit people, I'm just saying it'd be easier to move on eBay without doing anything to them. But me personally, I'd rather turn them into gaming PCs and flip them. As I pointed out in the last question, I derive a lot of satisfaction from building something, and I love improving on existing design, modding, all that. Plus, most of the people I've sold them to have been kids getting their first gaming PC, and it just reminds me when I got my first PC centuries ago. So there's a bit of nostalgia there. Plus there's the fact that you're giving the systems new life and keeping them out of landfill, at least for a little longer. Also, you don't have to deal with the headache of shipping the PC to buyers having issues with the system where you can't really help them fix it without sending it back. And as gaming PCs, they sell all right in my area, and one tip I can give you, if you're gonna turn them into gaming PCs, add some sort of lighting. People want the lights. I mean, there are people that don't, but most of them do. If you don't have at least an LED fan, you're gonna have trouble getting attention over all the other rave show PCs being listed. All right, next up. I have a 9020 small form factor. Do you have any idea if you can update the BIOS to boot from the PCIe bus? This one's interesting because on paper, it seems like you'd really wanna do this, but there doesn't seem to be a way because there isn't. Dell never really updated the BIOS for the 20 series mini tower, desktop, or small form factor systems to boot from the PCI Express bus. You can use a SATA or NVMe m.2 drive in a PCIe adapter as a storage drive, but you can't boot from it natively. And I say natively because there are ways as in bootloaders that you can use to make it work, but they're a pain in the butt, and I tell you, it's just not really worth it. And this is where it's not so straightforward. The reason being, you're not going to see the difference outside of benchmarks. Now, hold on, let me explain. On paper, an NVMe drive is a lot faster than a SATA drive, but it's highly unlikely that you're doing anything that will really take advantage of that speed. And if you are, it's also highly unlikely you're doing it on an older machine. So it's the literal definition of diminishing returns, where there's no perceivable difference without using a stopwatch. In fact, there aren't currently a lot of use cases where an NVMe drive is going to present a real difference for most people. That might be changing soon with gaming, we'll have to see, but an NVMe drive as a game drive with a recent GPU might make a huge difference when games start coming to the PC that can take advantage of direct drive access. Oddly enough, the 20 series Micro has an M.2 slot and can boot from it. I believe that's also the case for the ultra-small form factor, but don't quote me on that. Dell had the ability and chose not to add that feature to the other systems. Granted, it was early on for M.2 and those systems didn't have an M.2 slot, so it makes sense that they wouldn't add in that ability. Alright, next up. Are the motherboard and power supply standard sizes? That depends. Like I said in the first Q&A, the motherboard and the mini tower and desktop models are standard micro ATX. They'll drop right into any case that'll fit a micro ATX board and vice versa. The small form factor uses a micro ATX screw pattern, but the dimensions are not. For the power supply, there's no standard for ATX as far as length. However, the screw pattern and height are all standard ATX in the mini tower. But the length of the stock power supply is on the shorter side. There are a lot of options that are the same size as the stock PSU, and there are a lot that are a little longer, but they'll still fit. On the high end, a lot of models are a lot longer and won't fit without removing the side panel latch. In the desktop and small form factor, I believe they use TFX, and I'm not sure if the screw pattern is the same or the dimensions are exactly the same. I'd really need to get a system in to check it out. Alright, what would be a suitable quieter CPU fan? Well, first I'd ask why the fan is loud. I've never had one that I could really hear even when pushing the CPU. If it's too loud, I'd ask you to look at the CPU temps. Is it getting too hot? If so, you might need to change the thermal paste. Your ambient temps can affect this as well, but shouldn't be causing your fans to max out unless you live somewhere that resembles hell. And what about other components in the system, namely the GPU? If it's dumping a lot of heat into the case, and you don't have good ventilation, it will heat soak and raise the CPU temps. And none of these can really be fixed with a new CPU fan. Lastly, there's a chance that the bearing is going out on the fan and it's spinning too slow and not cooling effectively, and or it's making a lot of noise. In that case, the fan is a standard 80mm and it's easy to replace, but it's not without problems. Which is why it's easier to try to figure out why it's loud first. You can easily adapt the SL terminal for the fan to a standard 4-pin fan connection, but even then, the fan might work and still throw an F1 error at startup. I've been trying to find where the incompatibility lies, but I've not been able to find a pattern and I've tested a lot of fans. I've not found a single PWM 80mm fan that doesn't throw the error, so my suggestion would be to find a direct replacement, be fine with the F1 error, or be ready to do some trial and error. But if you're watching this and you found an 80mm PWM fan that does work without the error, please sound off down in the comments. And that leads right into our next question. Will installing an aftermarket CPU cooler do anything for performance? First off, I read the responses to this comment and they kind of irked me. They came off as pretty mean-spirited. Not only that, they were wrong. This isn't a stupid question and it isn't a straightforward answer either. The answer, as usual, it depends. In most cases, no, at least not to a degree that will matter. If you're running one of these lock CPUs that come with these systems, you shouldn't be running any higher than about the mid-70s, which is perfectly fine and you're not really losing performance. Lowering the temps down to the low 60s would theoretically allow you to maintain boost a little longer, but not to a degree that would give you a measurable performance jump outside the margin of error. Also, keep in mind that turbo boost is always on a timer, regardless, and that's affected by many variables like the type of workload, how many cores are active, current, power consumption, and yes, temperature. Voltage reliability and silicon quality are even factors that could cause boosting to be held back, regardless of how low you can get the temperature. There are a lot of variables here, and the fact of the matter is, you're not going to see a performance difference unless there's something wrong and you're seeing really high temps. And like I said in the last question, you should address why your temps are that high before slapping on another cooler, as it won't necessarily fix the problem. There's nothing wrong, and your temps are normal. Really, the only reason to do it is for looks. Alright, so kind of a similar question here. If you want to move past the stock Dell fans and or a better CPU cooler to squeeze out more performance on these older CPUs, do these systems require cable adapters? Also, if you drop a better cooler on board, could you do before and after on some game benchmarks to demonstrate what, if any, performance you'll gain from the improved cooling? Now, I already addressed most of this in the last two questions, but yes, you'll need an adapter, as the fan headers on these systems use a Molex SL terminal. And people like to say this, but they're not really proprietary. It's actually used in a few other PC applications. Anyways, Even with the adapter, there's no guarantee that you won't get an F1 error from the fan. There are a few people on the OptiPlex owners group on Facebook that have swapped coolers effectively, but the fan is a crapshoot, so perhaps we need to start a Google Doc as a database for ones that work and ones that throw errors for people that want to change the cooler or the fans. As to the other half, the previous question got me curious about this, so yeah, I'll be doing some testing on this, and I'll make sure to do a video showing the results. So get subscribed to see when that drops. Can you install an SFX power supply in the 790 small form factor? Technically, yes, but either it'll be too wide and you won't be able to close the side panel, or it'll overhang the board. With some creative modding, you might be able to make it work up front, but outside that, no. However, I'd ask why you want to change the power supply. Any low-profile GPU you could install would be more than fine on the stock PSU that comes in these small form factor systems, regardless of what CPU you have installed. If you're willing to cut a hole for a larger GPU, then you might as well do that for the power supply as well, or just leave the side panel off. What would you recommend for someone who wants to build a gaming small form factor PC? A low-profile 1050 Ti or 1650, preferably the GDDR6 model. They're currently your best options, and who knows what we'll see out of an LP model this gen, well, if we see anything at all. But maybe we'll see something in the range of a 1066GB to the 1070. Otherwise, you're going to have to start doing some custom fabrication, and at that point, I'd say you should just look elsewhere unless modding is your goal and you're just looking for some different challenges. Okay, so this one's a nice simple question. Does the 9020 support SLI or Crossfire? Crossfire, yes. SLI, no. Alright, so we have another power supply question here. With the 240W PSU, can you power a 1080? Also, would you be able to play VR with a Quest and an i3-4160, or will I need a better CPU or just a whole new PC? For starters, no. Absolutely not. You cannot run a 1080 Ti off of any 240W power supply. For a 1080 Ti, you're going to need at least a really good 500W, and that's only if you leave the clocks at stock. I've tested both of mine and they were pulling around 400 watts on an 8600K at 3440x1440p. As to the other half of your question, you're going to want at least an i5, but for a 1080 Ti, you're going to want an i7 to avoid a heavy bottleneck. Also, you're going to need a bigger GPU than what's meant to fit in your case, something like a 1066GB, 970, 1650 Super, or better. And any of those will need a power supply upgrade as well, so I'd say you need a different system unless you're willing to do some modding to make it all work. Components to consider if you're starting a Roblox streaming channel during the pandemic. Well, Roblox will literally run on a potato, so if we focus on the streaming, it should handle Roblox as well. For streaming, you're going to want to go with an i7, and I'd go with the 4th gen or at the very least a 3rd gen. Then any somewhat recent GPU with 4GB of VRAM will be more than enough. If you want to start streaming other games, you could run into a wall pretty quick though. What makes an OptiPlex more appealing than, say, a similar Lenovo ThinkCenter? You mentioned an HP alternative in a recent video. Those might be worth going over in detail. Well, I see Lenovo ThinkCenters as a minefield for people. There are a lot of issues with compatibility and they like to whitelist GPUs in the BIOS, which is a practice I can't stand. And even if I get why they do it, I feel like it's very anti-consumer and it just contributes to planned obsolescence. So I just tend to avoid them. That doesn't mean I refuse to cover them in the future, I just think there are better systems to cover that are a lot easier for people to deal with, like the HP systems and the OptiPlex. I don't know if I'll have time to get to any of the Lenovo systems before they're no longer relevant, but I'll try. That being said, I have a few HP systems here and I fully intend to make some overview and build videos on those. I'm actually working on one right now that I think will be pretty interesting, so keep your eye out for that. Well, we've got a lot of small form factor questions this time around, but what low profile GPU under 100 bucks new will be a good match for an i7-2600 and 16GB of RAM? Would an RX 550 be a good option? Literally, any current low-profile GPU is going to be the limiting factor with the 2600. So the 550 will pair just fine, though I don't know what the prices look like on those anymore, or if you can even get them new. And low-profile GPUs just tend to be more expensive anyways, since they're more of a niche market. But go with whatever's in your budget and you'll be fine. Just make sure the GPU will give you the frame rates you're looking for. I'm new to PC building and I wanted to ask if OptiPlex motherboards have a huge difference compared to other budget motherboards performance-wise. Now I really like this question and it's something I really want to do a video on, so I can't tell you with any certainty yet, but I'm working on some testing for that right now. But if I had to make a guess, I'd wager that you wouldn't see any difference between the board and an Opti versus a budget aftermarket board. If the Opti board is limiting performance, I believe it'll be due to the power delivery, more specifically the lack of phases, which you'll have on budget motherboards as well. I mean, I saw a budget H81 MSI board yesterday with a worse VRM package than the 3020. But if we're talking a much better board, like a Z series, well, that could be interesting. Anyways, I'll continue testing and I will be making a video on it, so get subscribed. Speaking of which, it's that time for me to tell you to do all the YouTube things, you know, like leave any of those comments or questions down below. I really do try to respond to most of them. Hit subscribe and click that stupid bell. And leave a thumbs up if you liked it, dislike it if you didn't. But as always, thanks for watching and I'll catch you with the next video.